Hi everyone, Oskar Świedat here. Welcome to part 3 of the tutorial about graphics profiling in Unreal Engine 4. In part 1, I explained how you can measure the performance of your game in milliseconds and in FPS, and the various console commands that are useful in that. In part 2, I covered the general GPU pipeline, so what happens under the hood, and how it affects your content. Now in part 3, it's about time to explain what profiling is. So, what is profiling? It's measuring the time it took to complete each function or a given block of instructions. For example, rendering all translucent meshes. By placing so-called GPU timestamps, Unreal can measure specific parts of the pipeline. Why profiling? Profiling allows you to compare different solutions. As I said in part 1, I urge you to act like scientists when approaching the optimization of your game. So you come up with some interesting theory, for example, that shadowed lights are the problem in your scene. Then you come up with some tests to allow yourself to check if you are right or not. And then the profiling is a perfect tool for that. It will be even more visible in part 4 when we will use an external profiler. But in this part, you will see that you can extract a lot of information already from the built-in GPU visualizer tool. It is a common saying in the programming area that every optimization is the root of all evil. Basically, it means, for me, it means spending time on unnecessary details like deleting single polygons or simplifying textures, while what you should do is to do profiling and find out that you are bound by shadowed lights that shouldn't be rendered at all because it's so far away. It all comes to the fact that profiling allows to pick your battles wisely. So how do we prepare for profiling? I suggest to place several fixed cameras across the level and check a typical in-game scenario. So place the cameras where typically the player would enter and what the player will have in view. Let me show you this in Unreal. What I do, besides of placing the camera actor, you can enter it here, perspective camera actor. There should be a list of all your cameras. Now as you can see, the aspect ratio is fixed, and I also want to ensure that the resolution is fixed. Because in the viewport, depending on the layout, I can have vastly different resolutions, which, as you know from parts 1 and part 2, can heavily affect your scene's performance. So to prevent that, I press the arrow near the play button, enter advanced settings, and in play in new window, I can specify the resolution I want the game to run in. Now I close the window, press play, and to run the GPU visualizer, I press Ctrl Shift Comma. This is the tool, the GPU visualizer, that pops up. So the GPU visualizer is a built-in tool. It has very precise categories, like begin occlusion tests, shadow depths, render velocities. And its most significant limitation is that it won't tell you the cost of specific meshes or specific typical lights. Only lights with shadows can be found in GPU visualizer. So again, I run it by pressing Ctrl Shift Comma in a running game. You can also press it in the viewport, but probably it will have some overhead from the editor. Sometimes even quite heavy overhead. So what the GPU visualizer does is showing a breakdown of a single frame on the GPU. This is a single frame that was captured, sort of, and the frame took slightly above 24 milliseconds to render. Now in the upper part you have a breakdown on the scene as a bar. This is a base pass, shadow depths, and the heaviest part was lights. In the case of my scene, it were lights. Here I also have translucency. Because this is a intentionally not optimized scene, I used here to be able to show you most of the examples in terms of categories. And then, when I have shadow depths, for example, I can expand it further and further. And here I have particular lights that cost me the most time in this frame when it comes to rendering shadow depths. And the top of each category is the sum of this category. Now, an important thing to know is that the GPU visualizer only shows up when you start the game from inside the editor. If you don't have an access to the editor, then not everything is lost. Because the build, when you run it, it won't show you the GPU visualizer, because we don't have the Unreal Engine editor UI. But if you press Ctrl Shift comma, it saves the information to the log. So let me exit the game, and then you enter your project name, saved, logs, and the current log. Okay. What you can see here is the same information and even more than you will get from the GPU visualizer, sorted chronologically. So all these categories, for example, begin occlusion tests or compute light grid, here they are sorted as they happen in the game. The engine begins with prepass, then it computes the light grid, then the base pass happens, and so on. So this is an interesting information in itself. You can also see the amount of vertices that were rendered by each pass. The same information that we had in the log can be also found in the editor, in Window, Developer Tools, Output Log, or, which is very convenient, in Window Project Launcher, when you launch your project and control it from inside the Unreal Engine. Let me run GPU Visualizer again. Sometimes it doesn't pop up. You have to close the game and maximize it, because it may be hidden. So, what can you find here? What is the most useful information for us? Let me recommend clicking duration here, so you will have it all sorted from heaviest parts to the almost invisible parts, 0 milliseconds. It's not zero, but it gets rounded to it, so very, very small amount of time. So this concludes first half of the part 3 of this tutorial. I explained GPU Visualizer, what it is, how to run it, what you can find in it. The second half of this tutorial, so part 3.2, is like the main part where I explain all the passes, majority of the passes you can find in Unreal Rendering Pipeline. So let's jump straight away to the second half. See you in a moment.